Hello and good morning, friends. Welcome to the CEC Edusit live lecture. Dear friends, as you know that in our previous three sessions, we have talked about life and work of Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar. We studied about his early childhood, about his education, as well as his contribution to the society. Dear friends, this is the fourth lecture in the series on Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar life and work. In today's lecture, we would be studying and we would be discussing on Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar's statementship at a round table conference, as well as his role for the Pune Pact. So, dear friends, I would like to tell you all, we have again with us for this discussion on Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar, and our expert today is Dr. Rakesh Kumar. Dr. Rakesh Kumar is Assistant Professor in University School of Law and Legal Studies, Guru Gobind Singh IP University. Dr. Rakesh Kumar has immense experience. He has been teaching since 10 years, and I believe that his experience as well as his hard work to make these edusit lectures lively, full of content, would make us beneficial. So without wasting any time, I would like to welcome our guest, Dr. Rakesh Kumar. Dr. Kumar, welcome to the edusit lecture.
Thank you, Geetika, and good morning, listeners. This is the fourth lectures on the life and work of Dr. Ambedkar. In my first lectures, I have given you the brief idea about the early childhood or stage of the Dr. Ambedkar and the kind of atrocity to which he was subjected in the early childhood, which has left very impressionable impact on their entire lifestyle. In second lectures, I have given you the detailed analysis of the kind of the academic achievement which was secured by the Ambedkar in a very short span of time, and the kind of contributions and or help which has been provided by the Maharaja of Baroda as well as the Maharaja of Kolhapur. And in that lectures, I have also emphasized about the work which he has done from the forum of the Bahiskrit Hitkarni Sabha as well as the Bahiskrit Bharat newspaper channels or magazines mediums. And subsequent to that, we have emphasized on the contributions which was made by the Ambedkars to the Maha Satyagraha and the temple entry movement at the Nasik, and how he had constantly agitated for the cause of the untouchable class, and he throughout his career he almost sacrificed his life for the providing the respectful place to the persons belonging to untouchable class. In the last lectures, I have also just touched some of the aspect of the first round table conference, where he has clearly lived his the act of statesmanship. So for the sake of continuity, today I am starting his contributions towards the round table conference itself. If you see that because the kind of the agitation which was going on against the Britishers in India, and the Britishers was clearly in mood to somehow satisfy the Indian agitators, and just to bring them for the negotiations, they have decided to call for the round table conference. And for this round table conference, they have invited the different personality of the Indian National Movement, and 53 delegates were called who were representing the different states of the national opinion. Apart from this, the Britishers has also invited the 20 princely states ruler for the participate in the round table conference. And if you see some of the very famous personality who have participated in the first round table conference, it comprises the Hindu liberal leaders like the Sri Tej Bahadur Sapru, Sri M.R. Jaikar, Sri Chiman Lal Sitalwad, Srinivas Sastri, Sri Y.B. C.Y. Chintamani, and for the representing the Muslim populations, here the British has invited the famous personality like the Aga Khan, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, Fazlul Haq, and as well as the Sir Muhammad Shagh, and for the representing the cause of the Sikh, here the Sardar Ujwal Singh was invitee of the Sikh, and Dr. B.S. Munje was asked to represent the Hindu Mahasabha. and Sri T.K. Paul were representing the Indian Christians. And as far the untouchable class is concerned, here the responsibility of representing the untouchable class has been assigned to the Dr. Ambedkars as well the Rao Bahadur Srinivasans. And if you see the contributions when the first roundtable conference was inaugurated by the King Emperors of the Great Britain, at that time the King George V was the king. So when in the inaugural speech the king has made a remarks that the may the your names go down in the history as those of the man who served the India Bills. And after the speech of the King Emperors, the Sir Ramsay MacDonald was elected the chairman of the first roundtable conference because he was the very popular labor leader and he was sympathetic to the cause of the untouchable class. And the in very opening remarks here, the Sir Ramsay MacDonald had declared that this first roundtable conference is going to resolve all the disputes which pertains with respect to the British government, and they wanted to solve the Indian problems and assess a new era in the Indo-British relationship. And after the speech of the Sir Ramsay MacDonald, here the Tej Bahadur Sapru was representing delegates from the Indian side, and their opening remarks here the Tej Bahadur Sapru has emphasized that the India wants and determined to achieve the status of equality with all the members of the British Commonwealth like the Australia, Canada, New Zealand, and equality with which will give its government not merely the responsive but responsible to the popular voice. So for the first time here the Tej Bahadur Sapru on the forum of the roundtable conference has clearly communicated to the Britishers that at the no cost they are willing to be subordinate to the Britishers, and they want their independent status in the line of the all other nations of the Commonwealth like the Australia, New Zealand, and they wanted a responsible government. And after the speech of the Tej Bahadur Sapru, it was the turns of the Ambedkars who was speaking on the forum of the first roundtable conference. And here in the first roundtable conference, Dr. Ambedkar has attacked very scathing on the deeds of the Britishers, and he on the forum of the roundtable conference, Ambedkar has clearly emphasized that 1/5 of the total populations of British India, a population as large as the population of the Great Britain, has been reduced to positions worse than that of the serf or slaves. So he maintained that the untouchable in India were also for the replacing the existing government by the government for the peoples as well as the by the peoples. So here from the first time Ambedkar has taken the stand that at any cost they wanted the responsible government to be governed by the Indian itself, and they wanted that the Indians should be given the responsibility of running the nation, so they will be ultimately accountable to the people of this country, and the persons who will be given the responsibility of providing the government, they will have the undivided allegiance to the cause of the peoples. And as for the approach which was adopted by the Britishers throughout the British rule, here he has emphasized that what the Britishers has done in the last 150 years for the cause of the untouchable class in India. And he has also emphasized that he has clearly stated that instead of the marching ahead of the times, we are simply marking the times. And in the kind of the speech which was delivered by the Ambedkars at the forum of the first roundtable conference, it has impressed all the audience who were the part of the first roundtable conference, and his speech has clearly impressed the Maharaja of Baroda, who was already impressed with the intellects of the Dr. Ambedkars, and the Maharaja of Baroda has decided to invite the Ambedkar for the special dinner. And in the speech which was made by the Ambedkars at that forum was clearly noticed by the all the newspapers, whether it is a British newspapers as well as the American newspapers, and they have given the very clear remarks to, they have clearly noticed the kind of the logical argument which was put forward by the Ambedkars at that forums. And even after the speech which was delivered by the Ambedkars, even it was also being acknowledged by the others English politicians and statesmen like the Lord Sydenham, O'Dwyer, who, and they also because before this speech they were also harboring the some kind of the suspicions regarding the Ambedkar's bona fide. And in the after that speech he was compelled to expel that he was not only the true Indian patriots and nationalist but also one of the revolutionary leaders of the country. And even after this speech of the Ambedkars, here the it is also on the record that the Britisher has constituted a secret inquiry committee to find out whether the Ambedkar is a true nationalist or patriot, or he is also one of the revolutionary like the Veer Savarkar and others. And it is only after the inquiry when it was found that he is the true nationalist and the and he is clearly concerns for the cause of the untouchable class in India, then the first round table conference has constituted a various committee, and Ambedkar was also very prominent members of almost all the committee which was constituted by after the first round table conference except the federal structure committee. And here he has been given the very important responsibility of the formulating the draft constitution with respect to the fundamental right of the people of this country as well as for the civil rights of the persons belonging to depressed class. And Ambedkar in the draft constitution has clearly outlined the various kind of the rights which may be given to the persons belonging to the depressed class, comprising of the cultural, religious as well as the economic rights. And he also outlined as to what kind of the civil right which will be available to the people of this country. And the draft which was formulated by the Ambedkar was appreciated by the his other partners of the that committee, including Dr. Munje, who was representing the Hindu Mahasabha. And the most positive point which has emerged out of this round table conference was the evolutions of the concept of free, united, independent India. In spite of the determined efforts which was being made by the Muslim delegate to ask for the separate status for the Indian Muslims. But if you see the achievement of the first round table conference, then definitely the first round table conference has not able to achieve all its objective, and it has failed with respect to the kind of disagreement which has emerged with respect to the persons who were representing the cause of the Hindus and the persons who were representing the others minority community, particularly the Muslims, Sikhs as well as the princely state. And there was a disagreement over the delegates regarding the kind of representations which they will have in the federal assembly as well as the provincial assembly. So with respect to that, here the first roundtable conference has clearly failed to achieve objective. But the one thing which was highlighted by that, here the concerns of the untouchable class was being brought at the forefront by the Dr. Ambedkar through his ceaseless effect. And he also emphasized that there has to be provision for the separate or joint electorate for the persons belonging to untouchable class. So after the first round table conference, here all the delegates have returned to India. And here so after the first round, there was other significant things which happened at that point of time, that is the Gandhi-Irwin Pact, because the Irwin was the viceroy of that point of time. And here at the advice of the British Prime Minister, the viceroy had decided to release some of the prominent Congress personality who were imprisoned at that point of time. And there was long protracted negotiations negotiations between the Mahatma Gandhi and the Irvins, and after that negotiations it was being decided that the Britishers would release the imprisoned persons from the jail. At the same time, it was also decided by the Congress that the Congress would suspend this civil disobedience movement, and it is willing to attend the next sessions of the round table conference. And at the same time, other important things which happened regarding that the government of Bombay has announced that the untouchable class would be eligible for entry in the police services. And since the Ambedkar was also one of the members of the Bombay Legislative Council, so from that forums he has sincerely works, and he has tried his best to somehow open both the police as well as the armed forces for the entry of the untouchable class. At the same time, the other things was going on that the Madras sessions of the Congress was going on, and in that sessions the Nehru was delivering a speech, and Nehru during that speech has clearly stated that the some of the members who had adopted the attitude that the persons who had participated in the first roundtable conference was the traitors. So what he stated from the Madras session that the Congress should not have this kind of impressions which was being made by some of the congressmen. So after this, then it was being announced that whenever the second round table conference will be held, then the Congress will also participate. And when for the second round table conference, the Britishers has declared the names of the delegates, and this name included some of the very prominent persons like the Dr. Ambedkar, then the Right Honorable Srinivas Shastri, Sri Tej Bahadur Sapru, Sri M.R. Jaikar, Sri Chimanlal Sital Wards, then Madan Mohan Malviya was also one of the delegates who were invited to participate in the second round table conference. Apart from this, the opportunity was also being offered to the Srimati Sarojini Naidu, Mahatma Gandhi, Sri Mirza Ismail, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, and Sri Ramaswamy Mudaliar. So these were the few prominent persons who were invited to participate in the second round table conference, which was going to be organized by the Britishers. And the Dr. Ambedkar, who was deliberately kept out by the Britishers from the Federal Structural Committee in the first sessions of the round table conference because of his staunch patriotic attitudes and his stance for the undivided, united and independent India, was given the very important responsibility, and that responsibility pertains to the drafting the new constitution for India. And when he was been given this responsibility, then it was acknowledged by almost all the newspapers as well as by the journalists not only in India but also in the Britain as well in the United Kingdoms. And one of the Indian Daily Mail who was earlier the very much opposed to the idea of the Ambedkar has clearly acknowledged the future role of the Ambedkars in the drafting of the new constitution of India. And here the Indian Daily Mail has paid tribute by saying that he is a patriot and is rightly interested in securing his government in the future discussion, which will center on the franchise, on the senates and the federal assembly. This brilliant representative of the depressed class is certain to play a most important role. So this is the kind of the tribute which was being paid by the Indian Daily Mail with respect to the kind of the efforts which was being put by the Ambedkar in the first roundtable conference. And apart from this, here the other newspaper like the Kesari, which was earlier hostile to the approach of the Ambedkar, has also acknowledged the role of the Ambedkars in the framing of the new constitution of India. And it was also being acknowledged by the other socialist leader like the N.M. Joshi. At that point of time, other things which has happened regarding that the Gandhi was released from the bail, and he was trying to meet as many persons to evolve a consensus regarding the kind of attitudes which has to be adopted by the Indian delegates in the second roundtable conference, which was earlier announced by the Britishers. And for this purpose, even the Gandhi wrote a letter to Ambedkar saying that he wanted to meet Ambedkars at 8 PM in the evening if it is convenient for the Ambedkars. And you can simply see that the Ambedkar on the same time wrote that he himself will call the Gandhi to meet him at that point of time, because at that point of when this letter had reached to the Ambedkar had just returned from the conference in the Sangli regions, and he was running with the high temperatures, and in the temperature has gone up by the evening, and that point he was not in positions to go to meet Gandhi. So what he did that he wrote other letter that as soon as he will be free from the high temperatures, he will see the opportunity to meet the Ambedkars. And that opportunity came on the 14th August when the Ambedkar visited to the Gandhi. At that point of Gandhi was having the very frank discussions with the Mirabhans, but the moment he saw that the Ambedkar has reached to that place, then both were having the very frank discussions with respect to each and every aspect and the kind of the approach which has to be adopted by the Indian delegates in the second round table conference. And in that meeting, you can simply see the simplicity on the part of Ambedkar that he acknowledged the efforts which was being put by the Ambedkars in the first meeting of the round table conference. And the Ambedkar on the Gandhi on the record has stated that whatever the report which I have received with respect to your contributions toward the first roundtable conference, I can simply say that you are patriot of the sterling world. So this is the kind of the tribute which was being paid by the Gandhi regarding the efforts which was being put by the Ambedkar with respect to the India's complete independence, as well as the Indian government to be governed by the people of India, for the people of India, as well as by the people of India. At the same time, he also highlighted the kind of the suffering to which the depressed class was being subjected during the entire British rule of almost 150 years. And the kind of the atrocity to which he has highlighted that it has clearly shaken the Britishers as well as the British Prime Ministers at that point of time. So what happened that the other important things which happened that by August 15, 1931, all the delegates of the round table conference has left for the London by ship. And here in that conference here the Gandhi had decided not to attend the second roundtable conference, because he had earlier stated after the suspending the civil disobedience movement that he would also participate in the second roundtable conference. But at that point he decided not to participate in the second roundtable conference. And so once the Gandhi decided not to participate, then the Sarojini Naidu as well the Madan Mohan Malviya has also cancelled his plan to visit for attending the second roundtable conference. So in the meantime, here all the delegates has reached to the London for attending the roundtable conference. But unfortunately, the Ambedkar was suffering from the attack of the influenza coupled with the vomitings and diarrhea, which persisted till 7th September 1931, the day the second roundtable conference was to open. And in the meantime, Mahatma Gandhi, Sardar Patel as well the Nehru met with the Viceroy at the Simla, and in that here the Gandhi agreed to attend the roundtable conference, so to be accompanied by the Srimati Sarojini Naidu as well the Madan Mohan Malviya. So he left for London on August 29 and reached there on September 12, 1923. So after reaching London, here the Gandhi was having the first time occasions to speak on the forum of the round table conference, and the entire world was looking towards this mystical figures of the Mahatma Gandhi who was attending the round table conference for the first time. And here the round table, as far the second round table conference is concerned, here the second round table conference has constituted two important committee. The first committee was the Federal Structure Committee, and the second committee was the Minority Committee. So as far the Federal Structure Committee is concerned, here the Federal Structure Committee to which the Ambedkar was earlier denied the opportunity, here he was also being made a members of the Federal Structure Committee, and the Federal Structure Committee was having the mandate to frame the structures of, or the kinds of the government which the India will have at the state level as well as the at the central levels. And if you see the role of the Gandhi during the second roundtable conference, when he was speaking from the forum of the second roundtable conference, then the here the Gandhi has adopted a very selfish, or the you can simply say that the kind of the approach which was adopted by the Indian National Congress at that point of time. And from the second roundtable conference here, the Gandhi has clearly stated that the here the Indian National Congress was the sole representative of the all India interest, religions and the caste. And his argument was simply based on the fact that the Muslims, Hindu and the peoples belonging from the depressed class are not only the active members of the Indian National Congress, but they have also holding or having held the very important positions in the Indian National Congress. And as per if you see the approach of the Ambedkar board, approach of the Gandhi board, then the Gandhi has gone to the extent by assuring the Indian princes that the Congress had refrained from any interference in the internal affair of any of the matters of the princely state. And Gandhi was also stated on from the forum of the roundtable conference that the Indian National Congress is also concerned for the cause of the women's, because here the Indian National Congress is also the sole representative of the women's, because they are having the members like the Dr. Annie Besant as well as the Srimati Sarojini Naidu. So, but the if you see the approach which was adopted by the Mahatma Gandhi during the address at the forum of the roundtable conference, but the same time here the Ambedkar has altogether taken a very different approach. And Ambedkar with his inborn temperament of the rationality and logic made his speech in reply to the Gandhi speech in the Federal Structural Committee. And here what the Ambedkar has stated that here he bluntly told the Indian princes that here the Federal Structural Committee could not give the everything which they are being just assured by the Gandhi during the address from the roundtable conference. And that is the most important aspect, that the total non-interference in the matters of the Indian princely state. Because here the Ambedkar has clearly stated that if the Indian princely state wanted this kind of concession, then they have to clearly demonstrate that they have the necessary resources as well as a capacity to provide the civilized life to all the persons who belong from that princely state. Because here the Ambedkar apprehensions was that the persons who are from those princely state, they are almost living in the conditions of the slaves, and their positions are very much they are subjected to the various kind of atrocity in the princely state because of the kind of traditions which is being followed in that princely state. So he clearly stated to the princely state that at any cost they are not going to give this kind of concessions to the Indian princely state. Apart from this, Ambedkar has also stated that as far as the Federal Structure Committee concerns, his main objective is that he do not willing to accept any kind of compromise, or he is not willing to concede anything which is being asserted by the Ambedkar by saying that Indian National Congress is the true representative of all the Indian religions, caste as well as the interest, because he wanted to secure a very prominent and respectable place for the persons belonging from the depressed class. So Ambedkar has clearly emphasized that he is not willing to concede anything less than the separate electorate for the persons belonging from the untouchable class. So this is the kind of the attitude which was being adopted by the Ambedkar in response to the speech which was delivered by the Gandhi at the forum of the roundtable conference. And apart from this, when the Ambedkar has made it clear his mind with respect to the status of the Indian princely state as well the kind of the concessions of privilege which has to be accorded to the to the persons belonging to depressed class, it was not appreciated by the Indian princes who were representing the round table conference, and one of the princely states representative like the Sri H.H. Sri Ganga Singh of the Bikaners, he stood up after the speech of the Ambedkars, and he clearly stated that here the Indian princes are not willing to sign on the blank check, and they are not willing to accord this kind of concessions which was demanded by the Indian, by the Gandhi through the forum of the International Congress. So apart from this, the other important things which was happening at that point of time is that the Indian National Congress, though they were having the organizations all in their level, but they wanted to establish the state people congress as an unarmed army of the Indian National Congress at every state levels. So when this effort was being made, because if you see that the approach which was being adopted by the Ambedkars with respect to the status of the Indian princely state, you can simply say that once the British had granted independence to India, then the Indian government has to even use the army to somehow persuade or coerce or force the Indian princely state to join the Indian federations. So you can simply see that as far as the thinking of the Ambedkar concerns, he was thinking beyond what his compatriot was comprehending at that point of time. So he can simply imagine that if this kind of concession would have been accorded to Indian princely state, then definitely in that case it will be something which will act as a hamper regarding the formations of All India Federations are providing the undivided or independent India, because all the princely state will demand that they should be given the sovereign status or they should be allowed to remain independent from the India. Because if you see, and when after the cabinet mission plan, when the Britishers has accorded freedom to the India, they have not simply accorded freedom to India, but at the same time they have also accorded freedom to the Pakistans, as well as the more than 750 princely states, and all these princely state was being given option either to join India or to join Pakistan or to remain independent. So you can simply imagine the kind of approach which the Ambedkar has adopted that point in time, or the kind of vision which the Ambedkar had with respect to the problem which he can foresee with respect to the princely state. So that's why he was not willing to accord any kind of the Indian any kind of concessions to princely state, and they have clearly stated that this princely state has to somehow adopt the line which has to be adopted with respect to the other persons. So apart from this, and when the Congress was trying to have the state level Congress organizer at every state, and when at that point of time, the other important things which happened at the Jawaharlal Nehru, who was the first Prime Minister of this country, when he was going to attend and address the State People Congress, State of Jammu and Kashmir, then he was being put under arrest, because here the most of the princely state has declared this State People's Congress as unlawful organizations. But if you see the approach or the kind of the verbal argument which happened between the Ambedkars as well as the Gandhi with respect to the every issue, that as far as the Gandhi approach concerns, here though the Gandhi wanted to have the federal structures, but at the same time they do not wanted to invite the Indian princes, so they wanted not to interfere in the matters of the Indian princely state. But at the same time, Ambedkar was in the view that the Indian princely state also has to follow the same line, and they have to somehow get assimilated in the national mainstream. Apart from this, there was also differences with respect to the differences between the Ambedkar as well as the Gandhi with respect to the untouchable class, because here the Ambedkar was clear in the view that the untouchable class should be given the separate representation in the both the provincial assembly as well as the federal assembly. But the Gandhi had adopted the attitude that since the persons of the depressed class also belongs from the Hindu religions, so there is no need that they should be given the separate status, because Gandhi was thinking that if the persons of depressed class would be given the separate status or separate implementations, then that case it is not going to ameliorate their conditions, and it is something which will hamper in their the larger visions or larger dream of the complete absorption of the persons of depressed class in the national mainstreams as well as the Hindu religions. So with respect to this point also, there was a difference with respect to the Ambedkars as well as the Gandhi, but as far as the Ambedkar was not having any kind of the difficulty when the Congress has conceded with respect to the separate representations to the persons belonging to the Muslims as well as the Sikhs. Though the modus operandi of the representation has changed, and when this communal award which was published subsequently by the Britishers, then definitely in that case here the Gandhi has completely considered the positions, and they have said that they have failed to somehow persuade the Indian Muslims as well as the Sikhs and Christians representative with respect to their representations with respect to the communal matters. So what happened there after the Federal Committee meeting, the other important committee which was constituted for examining the kinds of the right which will be accorded to the people of this country as well as the persons of the depressed class, and that was the minority community, the minority committee structures. And with respect to that committee, here some of the delegates like the Aga Khan and Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya had suggested for the adjournments or the postponement of the meeting of the minority committee, because they were viewing that this issue can be at best can be amicably resolved by the mutual negotiations between the delegates of the Sikhs, Muslims as well as the Christians and the Indian National Congress. So when this kind of the secret negotiations was going on between the representative of the Muslims as well as the Indian National Congress, then that point of time it was decided that the meetings of the minority committee has to be postponed at least for a week. But at that point of time, Ambedkar has clearly stated that he is not having any kind of objections if there is some kind of negotiations or some kind of the things is being worked out between the Indian National Congress and the religious representative of the Muslims. But at the same time, he is not willing to concede any of the rights which has to be accrued to the persons belonging to the depressed class. And so the first meeting of this minority committee, which was held on the September 8, 1931, and the opening address here, the British Prime Minister had admitted that the problems of the minority in India was indeed a baffling one. So after the suggestions of the Aga Khan and the Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, this meeting was postponed for 1 week. And later on, when the secret talk was going on between the Ambedkars and the delegates of the Congress as well as the Muslim leaders, then at that point of time, here the Ambedkar has clearly stated that if the depressed class would be he formally inquired from the Gandhi as to whether the depressed class would also be represented in the formal committee which the Gandhi was thinking of constituting for this purpose. So here the Gandhi, as for the approach of Gandhi's concerns, here Gandhi has straightway assured the Ambedkar that this would be done, and the Ambedkar has thanked the Gandhiji with this usual courtesy. So after this kind of negotiation, the other important things which happened regarding that after the conclusions of the second roundtable conference, here the Britisher has announced the communal awards. And here in that communal awards, here what is being stated by the Britishers is that here they are going to provide the separate representations to the persons belonging to the depressed class as well as the persons representing the Muslim community as well as the Sikhs and the Christians. But here, as far as this communal award is concerned, the moment this announcement was being made by the Britishers, then the Gandhi has decided to go for the fast onto death, because he was completely against the providing the separate representations to the persons belonging to the depressed class. And with respect to this matter, there was also some kind of disagreement between the Gandhi and the Ambedkars. But if you see, the because both were the persons of the utmost sincerity and the persons of the purpose, because and this kind of differences is most obvious, because when the two statesmen or the two great leader of that point were meeting and exchanging their view with respect to the kinds of the right which has to be accorded to the persons belong to depressed class, and the kind of the right which has to be kind of representations which has to be provided to the persons belonging to the Muslims as well as the Christians and the other minority community. But if you see the kind of difference, this is not something very unusual. You can also see the same kind of differences which has also prevailing at that point time with respect between the Gandhi and the Subhash Chandra Bose. Then the differences which were prevailing between the Kriplani as well as the Nehru, and the differences which was existing between the Jayaprakash Narayan and the Kidwai. Even the Kidwai has gone to the extent of the constituting his own party, and at that point time he has severely criticized the approach which was adopted by the Nehru. But here, the as far as the difference between the Nehru and the Kidwai concerns, it has not gone to the limit of never return. So, and when the Nehru has called the Ambedkar to somehow give up their differences and return to the back fold, then the Kidwai has simply returned to the Congress fold. So you can simply see that it is not unusual to have this kind of difference between the persons of the such a great statesmanship like the Ambedkars as well as the Gandhi. And even you see the when the Mrs. Gandhi was Prime Minister, and when she released the complete work of Ambedkar in year 1984, then in that time also Mrs. Gandhi has openly declared or the pronounced that the Gandhi was the persons of the complex characters. So this is the kind of the personality which the Gandhi was having. But at the same time, both the Gandhi as well as the Ambedkar was having the very strong command with respect to the verbal as well as the written English, and both were able to communicate with each other with respect to the intellectuals as well as the emotional planes. So it is not very unusual on the part of this two great statesmen to have this kind of differences. So what happened that this communal award was being announced by the Britishers, and here in that communal awards here the British Premier has declared that on the various provisions with respect to the communal issue India, and as per this provisions of the award, the depressed class were granted separate seat in the provincial assembly and the right of the double vote, under which they were to elect their own representatives and also to vote also in the general constituencies. So the moment this communal award was being declared by the Britishers, here the Gandhi has decided to go on the fast onto this on the issue of the separate electorate for the depressed class. And because what he was thinking that the depressed class is also persons belonging from the Hindu religions, and if this kind of the concessions will be given to the depressed class, then it is ultimately hampered in their complete assimilations in the Hindu religions. So for this purpose, once they have decided to go on the fast on to this, then the public appeals were made to the Gandhiji, and the statements were also issued in the various newspapers. And if the Dr. Rajendra Prasad, he has also expressed the view that with respect to this issue, Hinduism was on the trial. So this is the kind of the approach, the view which was expressed by the different statesmen on the Gandhi decisions to go on the fast with respect to the communal representations of the depressed class in the provincial assembly as well as the federal assembly. So once this declaration was made, then the hectic parley was held between the upper caste persons of the Hindu religions, and they wanted to have the some kind of meeting between the Gandhi and the Ambedkars. And for this purpose, here the efforts was being made, and the meeting was being arranged between the Gandhi Ambedkars and the Yerwada jail, because at that point time the Gandhi was imprisoned in the Yerwada jails, and the initiative was being taken by the very famous personality like the Sri M. R. Jaikar, Sri G. D. Birla, Sri Chunnilal Mehta, as well as the Sri Rajgopalachari, because the Rajgopalachari was the very unorthodox Brahmins of the South India, but at the same time he was also one of the sympathizer of the cause of the untouchable class. So, and when the, if you see that the, at that point of Gandhi was laying in extremely emaciated conditions on the iron cot with the jail mattress spread over it and under a low mango tree, and the Sardar Patel and the Sarojini Naidu was on the bedside of the Ambedkars, and the pervading atmosphere was that of the glooms. So, although deeply moved at the plight of the Gandhiji, who was almost on his deathbed, the Dr. Ambedkar controlled himself, since the main purpose of this meeting arranged by the common well-wishers of the both the leaders was to somehow bring the mutually satisfactory agreement between the Gandhi and the Ambedkars. And the Ambedkar, it was very testing time for the Ambedkar, because here the Ambedkar has to agree to somehow very difficult questions regarding the representations of the depressed class in the proposed federal legislative councils as well as the provincial assembly. So, as for the conversations between the Ambedkars and Gandhi's concerns, here the, it was held in the, almost in the atmosphere which was reminiscent of the between the two saints, and the Ambedkar was very logical in their arguments, and he has at the same time also very respectable towards the view of the Gandhi. So, as far the Ambedkar argument is concerned, here the Gandhi has clearly stated that you have my fullest sympathy, and I am with you with respect to the cause of the untouchable class, but at the same time when you are saying to me that your life is most concerned, then that time you have to realize that what kind of concessions which you have to made with respect to the my issue with respect to which I have taken the fast. So here the as far this hearing this here the Ambedkar, who was also he was very much deeply disturbed with the health of the Gandhi, who was almost on the deathbed in the Yerwada jail. So, when the kind of negotiation which was going on between the Ambedkars and the Gandhi, then that point of time here the Gandhi has clearly stated that you have my fullest sympathy, and I am with you doctor, and most of the things you say, but you say that what concerned you most is my life. And deeply moved by this statement, Dr. Ambedkar has answered that yes, Gandhiji, in the hope that you would be devote yourself solely to the cause of the my peoples and become our hero too. So, this is the kind of the attitudes which was adopted by the Ambedkar after seeing the Gandhi in that conditions. And even the Gandhi's reactions to the words of Ambedkar was equally memorable, and that Gandhi has clearly stated that, well, then if it is so, then you also know what you have got to do to save my life. So, do it and save my life. I know that you do not want to forego what your people have been granted by this award, because the communal award has clearly granted a separate electorate for the persons of the depressed class, and the Gandhi was clearly upset with this kind of attitude. So, Gandhi wanted that this kind of the separate electorate should not be accorded to the persons of depressed class, because it will ultimately hamper in their complete assimilations in the Hindu religions. But at the same time, if you see the kind of negotiations which took place between the Gandhi and the Ambedkars, and the kind of attitudes which was adopted by the Ambedkars by seeing the conditions of the Ambedkar, then that one time here one of the other important thing which was being noticed, that the here Gandhi has clearly stated to Ambedkar that you are untouchable by the birth and I am untouchable by the adoptions. So, we must be one and indivisibles. I am appear to give up my life to avoid this break of the Hindu community. And hearing this touching words from the persons like the Bapu, that Gandhi was also, Ambedkar was very much impressed. So he immediately agreed to the suggestions which was made by the Ambedkars. And after this, a compromise was being worked out between the Ambedkars and the persons who were representing to the Gandhi side. And under that compromise formula, it was being suggested that instead of the separate representations to the persons of the depressed class, here we will have the provisions of the reservations of seat for the persons belonging from depressed class. And for this purpose, as for the agreed formula, it was agreed that out of the total seat, 148 seat in the provincial assembly will be reserved for the persons belonging from the depressed class. And apart from this, it was also being agreed that out of the total seat, at least 10% of the seat will be given to the persons of depressed class among the total seat which was accorded to the persons of the Hindu religions. So this is the kind of formula which was being worked out between the representative of the Gandhi as well as the Ambedkars. But the one thing on which both were struck regarding that the issue of the referendum for the adult franchise for the untouchable in order to decide their own destiny. Here the Ambedkar, and with respect to this matter, here the Ambedkar was willing to see Gandhi again to discuss this matter. So here, as far the approach of Ambedkar is concerned, here the Ambedkar has to give the last chance to the Hinduism for making a voluntary expiations of his sinful past. And added that he was prepared that referendum on the issue may be held at the end of the period not exceeding the 5 years. So on the returning from this meeting with the Gandhiji, Dr. Ambedkar had thorough discussions with his common friends including the C. Raj Gopalachari, at which it was decided to make the agreement without conditions of referendum attached to it. And after this kind of the frank discussions which the Ambedkar had with his common friends, then the C. Raja Gopalachari met the Gandhi in the jail in the afternoon. The same day, Gandhiji has given his consent for this kind of settlement, and immediately after seeking the consent of the Gandhi, here the C. Raja Gopalachari rushed back to the Sri Sivlal Motilal Bangalore. And where the announcement was being made that the Gandhi had given his consent and blessing to this agreement. And speedily this agreement was drafted and signed at the 5 p.m. on the Saturday, on the same date, that is the September 24, 1932. And this settlement has gone down in the history of India as the famous Pune Pact. And if you see the kind of the signatory of this Pune Pact, then it comprises not only Ambedkars, but it also included the representative like the Pandit Madan Mohan Malbiye, then the Sri M.R. Jackers, Sri T.B. Shapru, Sri G.D. Birla, Sri Raj Gopalachari, Dr. Rajendra Prasad, Rao Bahadur Srinivasan, who was also one of the representatives of the depressed class and the first roundtable conference, Sri M.C. Rajan, Sri Devdas Gandhi, and some other delegates. And if you see the approach of the Raj Gopalachari, then the Sri Raj Gopalachari, he was a very orthodox South Indian Brahmins. He was so much overblown by this historic development that after this pact was signed, he exchanged his fountain pen with that of the Ambedkar. So you can simply see the kind of the magnanimity which was being shown by the persons not less than the Raj Gopalachari. And like the Dr. Ambedkar's Pandit Nehru and the Gandhiji and Raj Gopalachari all were completely determined for the complete transformations of the Hindu society as well as the abolition of the caste system. So here as far as this Pune Pact is concerned, here the Pune Pact is the other incident in which the very important incident in the life of the Ambedkar, because here this Pune Pact, because of the signing of the Pune Pact, he was subject to the severe criticism by his own peoples, and even some of them has gone to the extent by portraying him as a betrayer of the cause of the untouchable class. And even it is not something which has shaken the Ambedkar, because he has seen the kind of the the kind of the difficulty to which the Gandhi was facing, and he somehow wanted to save the Gandhi. At the same time, he wanted to have the respectable place for the persons belonging from the depressed class. And if you see the kind of the conversation which took place between the Ambedkar and Gandhi, because here the Ambedkar was very much clear that here the Gandhi is also wholeheartedly for the removal of this practice of untouchability from the Indian society. And as far the approach of the Ambedkar and Gandhi concerns, here Ambedkar was deeply touched by this Gandhi statement, that when the Gandhi stated that you are untouchable by the birth and I am untouchable by the adoptions. And so here he was clearly thoroughly clear with respect to this point, that the Gandhi is also a sympathizer to the cause of the untouchable class, and he also want to the immediate eradications of this practice of untouchability. But definitely the approach of the Ambedkar and Gandhi with respect to this matter was completely different. So after this, here the other meeting was held in the Indian Merchants Chambers, and that meeting Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya had addressed this meeting, and that meeting he had, through the presidential address, Pandit Malviya has declared that no one should be considered untouchable by the accident of birth. And he made a very impassioned appeal to the Hindu to see that untouchability disappear from this country. And this was also being seconded by the Sri Tej Bahadur Sapru as well as the other delegates of that meetings. And it was clearly decided that here the Gandhi had decided to give up his fast unto death. And subsequently the third round table conference was being held, which was not attended by the conference, and the nothing significant has happened with respect to the round table conference. But you can simply see the kind of attitudes or approach which was adopted by Ambedkar through the forum of round table conference, as well through the Pune pact for the cause of the untouchable class. I think the time will not permit to proceed further, but definitely we will try to have the more statesmanship aspect of the Ambedkar in the subsequent
definitely
lectures.
We would be talking more and more on life and work of Dr. Bhim Rao Ambedkar in our next session. Till then, take care, goodbye. Thank you, sir. Thank you so very much.
Thank you, Gitkas. Thank you, listeners.